everybody, it's Mike Jeff for ChicagoJazz.com and welcome to Talkin' Jazz. We are on location here at Cliff Dwellers, 200 South Michigan Avenue. It is one of the private civic arts organizations in the city, been around since 1907. I am here with the founder of the jazz series that's been being hosted up here in this incredible space, Lindsay Hughie, and the pianist who is going to be performing with his trio on October 25th. Chris White, and I'm sure everybody knows Chris White. Lindsay, I'm sure a lot of people know about the Cliff Dwellers Jazz Series because they've seen it advertised and pushed out different ways. I don't know how many people know you, so I think it'd be kind of interesting. Why don't we talk a little bit about the background, maybe of the club at first. I mean, 1907, we're up on the 22nd floor, 200 South Michigan Avenue. Is this the original location of the club?
No, Mike, the club was actually, the first location was just south of here on top of the Symphony Center building.
Oh, okay.
Until about in the mid-90s, it moved up here on top of what we used to know as the Borg Warner building at Adams and Michigan Avenue.
So it looks like just walking around here, there's some, should we call it artifacts from the old club? Because I mean, I see like the clock and there's paintings and there's different things. There's definitely an older feel on one side of the club as opposed to this side of the club. Do they move things over here when they transferred the club?
Oh yeah, yeah. They moved a lot of the common artifacts that are always with the location. And we have an archives, so it is a historic place. I mean, it was founded by Hamlin Garland, who was the first winner of the Pulitzer Prize, and Frank Lloyd Wright and Louis Sullivan were founding members of this club. Yeah.
What's the what's kind of like the mission statement behind the club? Has it always been the same, I'm assuming?
Well, it is actually up there on the fresco of the Kiva. You can, you know, I won't read the whole thing, but the mission is... it's a membership dedicated to preserving and cultivating the arts in Chicago. So it's an arts club.
And I mean, obviously, arts, you know, painting, literature, and music. Now, the jazz series you had up here, was there, I'm assuming there was classical and chamber musicians long before the jazz started happening up here. Has there always been music happening up here in different series and different presentations?
Yes, we always had music programs and presentations, and like you say, mostly classical. And then I wanted to bring America's classical music, jazz, and started that program 5 years ago up here.
So you must be a huge jazz fan in order for you to take on the... the work of getting a jazz series happening in the city?
Yes, I always have been. I've been a longtime member of the Jazz Institute. Mm-hmm. I have an MA thesis for an MA in history at Loyola, and it was on jazz in Chicago. So, yes, an appreciator. I'm not a musician, and so...
So how many concerts do you normally do a year? Is it, it's not every month, but it's...
Right, just 4 to 5.
Okay.
We've been getting good audiences, and so next year we will schedule more, probably in the area of 8 concerts.
Great.
Yes.
So that's great.
Yeah, people have been asking for more of them.
Now, October 25th, Chris White is going to be up here with his trio, which is going to consist of, why don't you tell everybody who else is
your
trio?
We have Mark Songson on bass, and on guitar, Terry Bartolotta.
So Chris, as a trio, obviously there's no drums, so you know I don't even know why I'm here. So,
sorry, Mike.
Yeah, I know. why don't we just cut Mike out of everything here? I'm just kidding. I'm a drummer. Everybody knows that. So,
so it's we'll good have to, you here. We haven't had Mike yet, but we.
He's I'm on, here now.
He's
on
I'm the schedule. Now. He is, yes.
I this sound the beginning. Best on camera. I sound the best on camera just like this, trust me. No, I'm just kidding. All right, so Chris, guitar, yes. Bass, piano, sounds like there's a lot of options, but obviously it leads back to one famous one, and I'm sure he's a huge influence on you. You're going to be doing any Oscar Peterson tunes that night because, you know, the famous trio with
Ray Brown and Herb Ellis.
Yep.
Yeah. Part of our set will be dedicated to some of the songs that they recorded. Not exactly the same arrangements, but in the same kind of vein, same kind of style. One album in particular we all really like is Live at the Stratford Festival, recorded, I believe, in 1956. with that same lineup. And we love the arrangements, the playing, the energy, and we want to emulate that same kind of feel that they had on that album.
Well, and also, I mean, let's talk a little bit about your background for the people that might not know. I mean, you grew up in Toronto.
Correct.
And went to school in Toronto before you went to
IU? I did my undergrad degree at the University of Toronto, not in music. Didn't think I could go into music. That's a whole other story. I won't get into it. But here I am. I actually have an English major. I was an English major at U of T, and then I took a year off and then applied to grad school and got into IU in Indiana. Studied with the great David Baker,
yep,
amazing pedagogue. Then moved to Chicago and virtually knew nobody except Nick Schneider on bass. I think I'll mention his name.
All roads lead back to Nick
exactly.
Schneider, doesn't it?
That's
how we met, is through Nick Schneider.
Yeah. And so he said, you got to come to Chicago, you can work, it's a great city for music. So that's how I wound up here.
Yeah. Well, and also, I mean, you came up, you started playing right away because you knew tunes.
Yeah.
You had a real strong basis in the jazz standards. And since we're talking about this, and since you're going to be performing here on October 25th, I know you're going to be playing a lot of jazz standards.
Yes.
But as an educator, because you also teach, where are the different universities you teach at? I mean, this guy teaches pretty much every university between here and Southern Illinois and
you
back
name
and forth.
It.
And
yeah. I'm at North Park University in the mm-hmm. city. I'm also at Lake Forest College North, and then out in Naperville.
Oh, they're all close together.
Oh, yeah.
Easy commute.
Easy. Oh, yeah. Wonderful.
Life of an adjunct.
That's right.
I love commuting. at North Central College in Naperville.
Yeah. So, you're teaching a lot. You're teaching, obviously, combos and quartets, but you're also teaching private lessons. You're teaching
all that courses.
Jazz courses and everything else. Mm-hmm. How important is it? Because I always like to kind of relate some of this stuff back. So if we have young viewers that are watching this, you know you've heard me ask this before to some of our guests. I mean, how important is it for young students coming up mm-hmm. to glom onto those jazz standards and learn where the history of the music came from? I mean, you got to learn from the masters, right? How did that help you in your playing?
You need to know the standards as a basis for anything. I mean, all the great masters knew that. You know, even the ones that sound really contemporary and modern, like say Herbie or Chick, they went through that process of learning the standards, and we try to impart that to our students as well, because you know when you go out and do a casual gig, you're going to be calling tunes and you got to know the repertoire. So yes, knowing the standards is super important, obviously. And we try to tell younger
who were some of your influences when you were coming up. I mean, Oscar obviously, but
big time.
Who were some of the other guys? Because all of this will probably relate to October 25th, because you're going to be able to come out and you're going to hear Chris play some of these standards, but you're also going to be able to maybe pick some of the little nuances out in his playing on some of his influences.
There are too many to name. I mean, just piano players alone. Anybody that played with Miles Davis, I think that, you know, I learned a lot from listening to Red Garland and Wynton Kelly, and you know, and then further along, Herbie Hancock and Chick Corea. It's just the list goes on and on, so it's pretty endless.
Yeah,
but you know, Oscar was the number one influence, and probably the reason why I got into jazz, because of the fact that, well, it was easy to find recordings in Canada of Oscar's work.
Well, he was living up there, wasn't he?
Yeah,
he was alive when you were up there.
I saw him, and I actually got to speak with him. I if I could tell a brief story,
please. We love stories here on Talking Jazz. It's called Talking Jazz.
And
storytelling jazz.
So I was just starting out. I had my first gig. I was 18 years old. And I actually knew where Oscar lived in Mississauga, because that's a suburb of Toronto where I grew up. So I knew not only where he lived, but my first gig was right really close to his house, like literally like blocks away. And so I met him at a record signing at HMV Records Toronto, was just opening up. And so I nervously had a card ready with my name on it and the restaurant.
In case you needed a sub or
something? Yeah, I was like, hey. So, and then I had my cassette of Night Train, one of my favorite Oscar albums, with me. And so he signed the album. And then I handed my card and I said, hey, Oscar, if you want to come see some great jazz, you know, said something, blurted something out, embarrassing, and come by the restaurant. And then so he took the card and he goes, okay, yeah, and he put it in his pocket, and he never showed up. But that was, admittedly, that was the year he had his stroke, so I think he was ill that same year. But I always imagined that he would have showing up. And
I like how you said
in
Oscar.
Spirit, he was
in spirit.
Right. Oscar, if you want to come and hear some great jazz,
yeah, right. Uh-huh.
Here's my car. I like that.
If you want to learn a thing or two, Mr. Peterson.
Right.
Right. You know, as opposed to anything else you've ever heard, you better come by this restaurant because it is going to be mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Well, that was a long time ago.
It
so
was.
October 25th.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now you can guarantee minds are going to be blown here with the Chris White Trio at the Cliff Dwellers, right? I mean, you've progressed that far in your playing that now you feel confident that you're gonna live up to the challenge that you gave to Oscar all those years back, right?
I hope so. I'll
no pressure.
I'm confident that he will do very well in
thank
the
you.
Oscar Peterson tribute.
Yes. Thank you very
absolutely.
Much.
Absolutely.
I appreciate it.
I'm a big fan.
So
count me.
So let's talk a little bit about the layout of the evening. Lindsay, so it starts, 5:30 to 9:30. And there's two or three sets? Or?
Just two sets. First one is 6 o'clock to 7:15. And then we have a buffet dinner going on that's optional. Any guest who comes can buy that. We recommend a reservation in advance. We have a small kitchen here. But so we do a dinner break around 7:15 to 7:45. And then the second set goes to 9 o'clock.
So with the dinner buffet, since we're talking about that, you want to call in advance. You can call the club directly, but you want to do it a couple of days before October 25th. So 312-922-8080, 312-922-8080. We're going to link that up below. That's with the buffet. That's $25. But what is it? It's a little less expensive if you just want to come up and have some drinks and check the whole club out.
Right. It's a $10 door charge, and then we have a full bar. And yes, you get to visit the club, and the door charge goes to the artists because we are supporting the arts here.
And also, just you know, aside from the music, aside from the buffet and everything else, the view at this club is
great.
Unbelievable. When you look out, you can see Lake Michigan. Now it's going to be dark, but you can still see Lake Michigan, and you can still see the boats and the landscape of the entire city. We're overlooking Millennium Park. And there's an outside area that you can stand out there in between sets probably and check things
sure.
out and have a
smoke
cocktail.
Smoke a cigar
mm-hmm. on the balcony out here on the 22nd floor. So it's something that you're not going to see at every club. And if you have an opportunity, if you want to see something unique and you want to see live jazz in a unique setting, it's early enough that you can get out Thursday night, October 25th. Chris, what's your website?
Oh, I thought you were going to shake my head.
I will. But what's your website anyways?
Yeah, it's chriswhitepiano.com. And you can, check out. I have my sound samples up there and all other stuff.
You got a couple of recordings.
I have a couple of recordings, yeah.
You've got different things
coming up. And
you're
on one.
I am on one.
My last
right.
album, and I'm due for another one. So,
that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. That was a good album.
So maybe, as I'm sitting here next year, one of our scheduled groups will be the Chris White Piano Trio, enlarged to the quartet with Mike on drums.
Hey, there's
an idea.
All right,
yeah.
I'm
liking
this.
Oscar did, right? He did.
Yeah,
I'll play the Ed Thigpen part.
That's right. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. One of my favorites.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ed Thigpen, right here. Say hello.
I don't want to go that far yet. And actually, Chris and I used to play together a lot. So back in the day, we had some crazy gigs. And at some point, I'm going to have Chris come down to the hot dog stand, and we're going to delve in.
Oh, that'll be fun.
We're going to delve into the Sopranos gigs. And
oh, that goes way back.
And
yeah.
the Peninsula gigs.
Yeah, okay.
And all the other good stuff. But right now, we're going to see you October 25th. Lindsay, thanks so much for allowing me to come up to the club and shoot this episode of Talkin' Jazz.
Thank
Chris,
you, Mike.
Thanks for coming down.
Did I get to shake your hand?
Absolutely. I appreciate it.
I already shook yours.
Can I shake yours?
You can shake mine, yeah.
All right, and of course, hopefully we'll see you October 25th, but if they don't see you somewhere before then and I don't see you somewhere soon, hopefully I will see you somewhere out on the scene.